Melinda presents this unabridged recording of Wild Things, How We Learn to Read and What Can Happen If We Don't, written and read by Sally Rippin. To my three sons who fill me with love, awe and gratitude. Note to the listener, this is a personal journey. While I have spent several years researching this topic and interviewing experts, only you will know what is right for your child. All advice within is simply to be taken as if shared with love and a cup of tea over my kitchen table. Also, in writing this book, I consulted with friends and professionals in the disability community about the most up-to-date language around labels and terminologies. Following their advice, I have chosen to use identity-first rather than person-first language. That is, rather than writing a person with dyslexia or a person with autism, I refer to dyslexics and autistics. I use a capital A for autistics, autism, as this is commonly used in the self-advocating autistic community. However, it is less common to use a capital letter for dyslexics, dyslexia, as this term is often used to describe a broad spectrum of reading difficulties. When it comes to ADHD, I refer to having ADHD, as the acronym doesn't lend easily to identity-first language, though some people refer to themselves as ADHDers. Identity-first language is often used to show allegiance and pride in disability or neurodiverse culture. However, some people choose person-first language, preferring not to think of their disability as their whole identity. If you are unsure what terminology to use, listen to how people define themselves or ask how they would like to be described. Wild Things. In Morris Sendak's most famous story, Max is king of all wild things. We are invited to join him on his adventures and revisit the untamed jungles of our own childhood imaginations without giving a second thought to his mother's exasperation. Sendak asks us to empathise with the child's perspective, following him into the land of wild things. When Max eventually returns, his supper is waiting for him, and it is still hot. Despite feeling like he has travelled for days, weeks, possibly even more than a year, in reality, Max hasn't been gone that long at all. Most importantly, despite his monstrous behaviour, we see he is still loved. This is perhaps why this book resonates with adults as deeply as it does with children. It reassures us that no matter how badly we behave or how far we roam, we are all still worthy of love. We love wayward children in literature, and a story goes nowhere without conflict. A character who follows the rules and makes no mischief is boring, and we fall most deeply in love with those who are troubled or flawed. But when children are like this in the real world, we often respond very differently. A few years ago, I was asked to speak at a bookseller's conference in Tulsa, Oklahoma. As a children's author, I travel regularly to talk about my work. I speak at festivals and run workshops, and also work as a writer in residence in schools all around the world. It's a delightfully unexpected bonus to a job I already love. I've been invited to some fascinating places and met some incredibly interesting people along the way. This conference, though, was a pretty big deal, and I was very nervous. I've spoken to some large audiences over the past 25 years, parents, teachers and librarians, and of course, lots and lots of kids. But this was going to be an audience of over 1,700 sales consultants who, if they liked my books, would hand sell them across the United States. It was an amazing opportunity, and I really didn't want to mess it up. The Billy B. Brown series was already doing well for my American publishers, and so they'd invited me to introduce my newest series, Polly and Buster, to their sales consultants. I had a slideshow I'd been using in Australia in the few years since the books had first come out, which had been road tested and well received. But for some reason, the night before my presentation, I decided I wanted to talk about my son. I had debated for days whether this was a good idea, even though my son, who, for the purpose of this book, I will call Sam, had already given me permission to talk about him. I didn't know my audience well at all, and I wondered if talking about my kid to a room full of strangers was too personal, too unprofessional. Right up until the night before, in my hotel room, jet-lagged and far from home, I kept writing him into my speech and cutting him out again. The next day, after very little sleep, I sat in a room the size of an airplane hangar, arms goose-pimpling with air conditioning and nerves. I had found out that morning I would be appearing right after a motivational speaker, as if I wasn't nervous enough already. I watched the speaker stroll confidently up and down the stage, my stomach curling inwards as she chatted into her headset mic. She wore a navy suit jacket, jeans and sneakers in a way that was effortlessly chic, clicking through motivational slides as she inspired the audience of almost 2,000 people, predominantly women, to push harder, go further, aspire for more. I tried to internalize her advice, but all I could aspire to at that moment was getting through my presentation without passing out in fear. She was heart-sinkingly good, funny, warm, and entertaining in the way many Americans seem so naturally able to be. I ran my clammy palms through my frizzy hair, wiped my hands down my crumpled trousers, and focused on staying calm. I tried to recite my personal mantra. They only want to see you, Sally. That's all you can be. But I still found it hard to convince myself, as a foreigner in this country of celebrities and fairy tales, that me was going to be enough. Finally, it was my turn. Even though I'd done a fair amount of confident stage strolling myself, this time I was sticking to my notes and clinging to the lectern to keep me upright. To my instant relief, when I looked out at the audience, I realized I could barely see a thing. The stage lights were bright, and once I had my reading glasses on, everything more than a couple of meters ahead of me was a blur. I glanced down at my notes, written out word for word in case I blanked out on stage, even the jokes. I began my talk by bungling my first joke, but then I managed to make the audience laugh by joking about how I'd bungled my first joke and proceeded to flick through the slides. I knew these slides well. I'd been touring the Polly and Buster series for almost 3 years by then, so I relaxed a little once my images were on the screen behind me. I was warming up and finally able to hear my voice over my own heartbeat. Eventually, I came to the part where I would tell the audience about the inspiration behind the books. I could see the next slide featured a photograph of Sam. I took a deep breath. The mood of my talk was about to drop suddenly from light and funny to heavy and earnest. I hoped I could keep the audience with me. I clicked on the next slide, and Sam's sweet face loomed large on the screen behind me. I explained that this photo had been taken several years before, when Sam was 7, the age when it became evident that he was struggling to keep up with his classmates. Like many parents, his father and I had been going into his classroom once a week as parent helpers to listen to the students practice their reading. That was when I had discovered things were going awry. Over the space of that year, I had listened to Sam's classmates read aloud until, one after the other, they graduated from the class set of educational readers and began bringing in their own books. Some of them brought in fairly simple books and still stumbled on the odd word or two, but others were zooming ahead onto books like Harry Potter and the stories of Roald Dahl. Slowly but surely, over the space of that year, I saw every kid in Sam's class eventually click with reading. Every kid, except for Sam. Sam wasn't progressing at all. In fact, he seemed to be going backwards. Not only was he still struggling with the lowest level of reader in the class set, he was also beginning to say things like, "I hate books, I hate reading," and eventually, "I hate school." Naturally, I began to panic. How could my kid hate reading? Sam had been born into a family of readers. He had grown up surrounded by books. His dad and I had read to him every night from birth. We had done everything right. I was a children's author, for goodness sake. My two older sons loved school and found reading easy. I don't remember them ever really struggling to learn. They just seemed to pick it up without much effort at all. But despite Sam's very clear message and the huge red flag that it was, I had no idea what to do. I now know there are lots of things I could have done. Any one of them could have saved Sam years of heartache, but back then, no one around me seemed particularly alarmed by his struggles. All kids learn at different rates, I was told. He'll catch up eventually. They all do. One day it'll just click. Even the educational psychologist we took him to that year, who spent two sessions taking him through a long and complicated assessment to discern exactly how far behind his peers he was, spoiler alert, a lot, assured us when I asked if Sam could perhaps be dyslexic that it was probably too early to tell. Then she handed me a printout of the assessment, full of acronyms and terminologies which I still struggle to get my head around, and told me to pass it on to my son's school. That was that. Perhaps I hoped it might sort itself out over time, or maybe I told myself Sam might just not be a reader, but it wouldn't really matter. He would eventually find his thing. So I packed away my concerns, busy with work and family and all the things life throws at you. Still, each night at bedtime, Sam's dad and I forced Sam to struggle through his school readers, thinking he would eventually get there. It was torture. He writhed and complained and would look for any excuse to get away. Some evenings it took three glasses of water and four toilet trips just to get him through a few pages. I would suck in my exasperation, breathe deeply to calm myself, and try not to gasp with frustration when he couldn't recognize a simple three-letter word from one page to the next. "You just saw this word 2 minutes ago," I would remind him in absolute astonishment. But Sam would have had more fun sticking pins in his eyes. Some nights he would beg me in tears not to have to do the reader. They were so boring. I couldn't help but agree. So, as a children's author, the only thing I could think of to quell my growing feelings of helplessness was to write him something he might want to read. Until that moment, I had always written for the reader I had been as a child. I had devoured books with complex language, dense text, and meandering plots, so those were the novels I had set out to write in the first part of my career. Books that were deemed literary and might be shortlisted for awards because they were clever and challenging and showed off my writing prowess. But after witnessing Sam's struggles and not finding anything that would engage him, I realized I needed to change my approach. I decided I would no longer write the kinds of books I had enjoyed. Instead, I would write books for kids like Sam, kids who declared they hated reading. There were already plenty of beautifully written, sophisticated novels for children who were good readers, and even plenty of funny, easy reads for kids who'd been pigeonholed as reluctant. But I still felt there were few books that had complexity and depth, relatable characters and heart, and that were written in accessible language for kids who genuinely struggled to read. So I set out to use the language of a school reader and the shortest sentences I could manage, all the while still making them feel like proper books. Books with chapters, character development, and actual stories, something desperately lacking in the educational readers Sam was forced to plough through. With these parameters in place, I created the Billy B. Brown series and later, at Sam's suggestion, Hey Jack, a spin-off series featuring Billy's best friend. I admitted to the audience that when I first started writing these books, I had no understanding of reading difficulties at all. My hope had been simply to write stories that were engaging enough to entice kids like Sam to at least give them a try. I tested every story out on my son before I sent it to my publisher. I would watch him carefully as I read the stories aloud to gauge where I might have lost his interest. Each story I would rewrite again and again, paring back the text, shortening the sentences, or speeding up the story to keep his attention. My theory was if I could keep Sam interested, I could keep any kid interested. But back then, I had no idea how much struggling to read could impact every aspect of a person's life, not just school. I told the audience how quickly things had deteriorated for Sam, especially once he got to high school, and explained that Sam is the reason I made Polly, the main character in my new series, dyslexic. I wanted my readers to know that even though school can be a nightmare for kids with learning differences, once they found their true gifts, they would shine. Even though at that stage, Sam was so very far from shining. I told them I had decided to give Polly a best friend called Buster, whose feelings were so overwhelming, at times they would literally make him change shape and colour, expanding pink with happiness and shrinking to grey with sadness. Buster felt he had to hide his feelings from the other monsters at his school because he was afraid they would make fun of him. I had witnessed firsthand the devastating effects of shame on a young person who knows they are different and unlike anyone they know. No matter how much the grown-ups who love them might say that being different is special, this means nothing when the other kids at your school just assume you are dumb, and even when some of your teachers have written you off. All of these
characters. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.